Torres. Welcome to another edition of Best in Boxing, coming into you from the Big Punch Arena in Tijuana, Baja California, Mexico. Hi, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Chris Martin, and here tonight we have our main event in Kevin Torres facing late replacement Alejandro Almada, coming in on one day's notice. Also on the card here tonight, we have Jorge Brito, who in December 2018 defeated main event fighter Kevin Torres, gave him his lone loss to Kevin Torres, and being joined here by my broadcast partner, professional prize fighter himself, Simon Torres. Now, Simon, as a fighter, you defeated the main event fighter, but you're not the main event fighter tonight in Brito. You're the co-main event. How do you feel about that? What type of work do you put in tonight?
Well, Chris, you know what? It's going to make me have a big chip on my shoulder. I'm going to see it as a little bit of an insult. At the same time, use it as motivation to get in there and outshine the guy who's in the main event, because I did beat him.
Yeah, absolutely. And it was a very good fight. And possibly, Simon, they're on the card here tonight as the main event and co-main event. And possibly down the line, we could get a rematch.
El Big Punch Arena. Desde la frontera más visitada del mundo, Tijuana, Baja California, México. Este evento es sancionado por la Honorable Comisión de Box, Lucha Libre y Artes Marciales Mixtas de esta ciudad de Tijuana. El presidente Carlos Labastida, comisionado de boxeo Jesús González, el jefe de servicios médicos, el doctor Benjamín Sandoval, al frente del tiempo César Fernández, concertador de eventos Raúl Montes. Sus tres jueces, Sergio Lechuga, Jesse Sánchez y el juez internacional, José Cobian. Y su referee para este combate, de la Isla del Encanto, Puerto Rico, Ángel Méndez. También damos la bienvenida a nuestros amigos que nos siguen a través de las redes sociales en Facebook, YouTube, a través de Fight Hub TV y The Best in Boxing, VIP. Ahora sí, damas y caballeros, prepárense, cuatro rounds de combate en la división de peso crucero. Ladies and gentlemen, four rounds of boxing in the cruiserweight division. Introducing first the fighter standing in the blue corner. He wears black with green and white. He officially weighs in 178 pounds. Presentando ustedes en la esquina azul, con pantalones de color negro con verde y blanco, con un peso de 178 libras. He stands with two professional bouts. Cuenta con dos combates profesionales, representando su natal Hermosillo, Sonora. Brandon Acuña. And his opponent across the ring is dead.
Those are good shots by Price already. And Acuña took them well.
Yeah, you know, Price started at an, you know, not the youngest age, but he looks healthy and he looks pretty conditioned there. So.
Yeah, absolutely, man. His body looks rock hard, man. So he could definitely do some damage here tonight to Acuña, who doesn't look like he's in the best of shape. And Simon, despite the fact that Price turned pro in October 2019, he already has three professional fights, October 2019. That's close to about 4 months. And he looks pretty poised here tonight. He's fighting behind the jab, good postures. You know, one thing I didn't know, though, is that he's a southpaw and seems to be working to his advantage right now.
Yeah, he seems to know how to keep that lead foot outside the opponent's lead foot. taken fighters to, made them at world, made them into world champions.
Yeah, absolutely. Props to Vince Parra, you know, former trainer, and got Maurice Hooker to that world title. They crossed the pond, came back with the belt. You know, whether they're currently in that situation or not, but they're former coach and
yeah,
fighter,
yeah.
And Vince Parra and Maurice Hooker.
Seems like Darnell Price is starting to really settle down here. He came storming out of the gate.
Yeah, just kind of going back behind his jab. And Acuna already, you can see a little bit of blood coming from his nose.
Yeah, you know what? The one thing about, as he stumbles as he comes to the corner.
And you see the corner wipe down the blood. And right away, Simon, as a fighter, blood coming from the nose right away in the first round. Can't be a good sign, right?
Correct. You know, as a trainer, you don't want to bring that up, you know, to him. He, if he understands he's bleeding or not, you just want to let it be. You want to get him to focus on what needs to be done in the next round.
And as a coach, if you were in the corner right now of Acuna, what could you possibly say dealing with a much bigger Darnell Price? And for the most part, he seems a little bit more skilled right now, too. I don't think I've heard that one before. And here we go as we start round number two, Darnell Price versus Brandon Acuna. In this round, Acuna starting a little bit more head movement. Maybe that's what they told him in the corner. He's got to move his head. He was getting hit with too many shots in that first round. Yeah, definitely. I mean, aim at the chest. The head is going to move, but the body's going to stay there. So yeah, you're right. Aim at the chest. Yeah, absolutely, Simon. You know, I could attest to that. You know, I did a lot of training down here in Tijuana. You know, I started my professional career pretty much boxing down here, getting my training partners, you know, getting me ready for my first few fights.
Oh,
and
right.
Down goes Acuna.
Now, what do you do in this situation, Chris, as a fighter, when you have your opponent hurt?
Well, like you said earlier, like Darnell Price, he was staying poised. I believe he should continue to stay poised, and he could get Brandon Acuna out of here.
Definitely.
And it seems like that's what it's going to happen.
Wow. Man, Price is a big boy with a lot of power. He's down.
And Brandon Acuna gets up again, wanting more from Darnell Price.
Acuna trying to stay poised. Price going for the big shot.
Easily slipped by Brandon Acuna.
I like how Price keeps his range at this time. He was falling in a little early. Maybe he needed to settle down. Wow.
And those are heavy shots coming in from Price.
We're here ringside, and we can feel those up here. Oh, Price just
thuddy body
shots. Fight's over.
Body shots.
And a knockout victory for Darnell Price in his fourth professional fight. He remains undefeated.
Professional fighter. 5 month professional fighter.
Wow.
With a 4-0 professional boxing record. Outstanding.
Now that's how you stay busy.
And definitely. You know what? One thing I did want to mention, you know, I asked Darnell Price in the fighter meetings, Darnell, what's the plan? You know, you're starting off, you're 28 years old. What's the plan for 2020? He said, at the end of 2020, to be 10-0.
Wow.
And this, right now, the way he looked,
yeah,
you know, getting this guy out in the second round, it seems it seems doable. It seems completely possible that he'll be 10-0, especially with a good cornerman in Vince Parra.
Yeah, definitely. You know, some people may think it's a late start, but you know what? He's been in shape being in the Marines, so it's no surprise for the training, you know, and from that aspect. And if he stays this busy for a few years, he could possibly make a run for a contender, and then being with the coach he's with, he's been to that level.
Yeah, been to that level, has those connections, and that's what you want. And here we go to our ring announcer, Pablo Flores.
Damas y caballeros, este combate concluye con un tiempo de 2 minutos 29 segundos en el segundo asalto. We have the official time at 2 minutes 29 seconds in round number 2. Declaring your winner by the way of TKO victory. Su ganador por la vía del knockout técnico. San Diego, California, USA. Darnell Price. Still undefeated.
What a good way to start off the fight. I mean, start off the night with a second round knockout, Simon. You know, good performance by Darnell Price. You know, and starting off 2020 with the bang, man. And like he said, he wants to be 10-0 by the time the year's over.
Yeah, man, he keeps this pace up like that and getting guys out of there early. It's very, very attainable.
Very attainable. 10-0 by the end of the year. Best in boxing, we wish you the best, Darnell Price. Coming up next, in a cruiserweight, excuse me, in a flyweight division. So once again, we have the cruiserweight division. I'm over here getting my notes mixed up, Simon.
Yeah, that's okay.
So once again, in the cruiserweight division, we have Ben Alvarez from San Diego, California, fighting Jorge Luna from Agua Prieta, Sonora.
Yeah, he's actually a Canadian, from what I'm told, Ben Alvarez. He's been in some sparring sessions with Canelo Alvarez, too. And he's a big guy, and he's I guess he moved here from over there searching for a gym, found House of Boxing, made a good relationship with the coach, started training, and we'll see what he can do.
Yeah, I was going to touch on that. That's a good story as well. You know, you come, and you know how great it is, the fact that we have that in San Diego. You have the House of Boxing, and people know it, you know, typically because that's where Canelo Alvarez was holding his press conferences and coming in and doing his training. We all know that Canelo does live somewhere in the outskirts of San Diego,
yeah,
California.
We can't say.
We can't disclose that location. But yeah, you know, you have the House of Boxing backing Ben Alvarez. And that's what you want as a young fighter coming into a bout like this, you know, getting your feet wet in the professional ranks with a great corner already.
Yeah. And you know what? He has a pretty solid amateur background. You know, he has about 48 fights amateur, and he was on the Canadian national team. So that tells you he's faced some high-level opposition, you know, in the amateurs.
As we see Ben Alvarez walking into the ring.
Yeah, these are both mine.
Damas y caballeros, Boriseca Boxing Promotions presenta este combate pactado a cuatro asaltos en la división de peso crucero. Four rounds of boxing in the cruiserweight division. Your three judges scoring this bout in ringside. Sus tres jueces, Jesse Hernandez, Sergio Lechuga y José Cobian. And your referee in charge of the action, su referee para este combate, Ángel Méndez. Introducing the fighter standing in the blue corner. He wears black and red. He officially weighs in 190 pounds. Su rival presentando la esquina azul con pantaloncillo negro con rojo con un peso de 190 libras. He stands with a record of 0-1. Cuenta con un récord de 0 victorias por una derrota. Representando Agua Prieta Sonora, Jorge Luna. And his opponent across the ring is standing in the red corner, wearing white and silver. He officially weighs in the same, 190 pounds. Y su rival en la esquina roja, con pantaloncillo color blanco con plata, con un peso idéntico de 190 libras. Making tonight his pro debut, haciendo su debut profesional. Originally from Edmonton, Canada, by the way of San Antonio, Chile. Representing House of Boxing San Diego, California, USA. Benjamin Ben Alvarez. And now to give out the final instructions, your referee in charge, Ángel Méndez. Four rounds, cuatro saltos.
And here we go in our second cruiserweight fight of the night. Ben Alvarez, pro debut versus Jorge Luna. And Simon in the corner of Alvarez, what do you say? What do you tell him coming into his very first professional fight, fighting a guy who has already been in the professional ranks?
Well, you know what I would tell a fighter on their first fight is? What I would tell on a first fight as a fighter is to take everything you've been in the gym. This is just another sparring session, and it's okay to go for the kill here.
Yeah, absolutely. Sometimes kind of take your foot off the pedal in sparring, but in the fight, you go pedal to the metal.
Yeah, let him go. And that's what it looks like. He looks like he's on the hunt here. Oh, with the lead hook. Luna looks to be in trouble already here.
Yeah, he doesn't seem stable.
Quick to grab Alvarez.
Solid jab by Alvarez right away.
Yeah, I mean, his best weapon is his reach, timing, and power. This guy, especially the House of Boxing, they show their fighters a lot of how to sit on that punch.
Yeah, definitely coming from a boxing gym that is known for coming up with bringing up good fighters, you know, like the House of Boxing.
Oh,
hard thudding shots from Alvarez.
Yeah, he's keeping his distance too. He's not. We saw that Luna grabbed him earlier. It seems to have caught on to that, so we're staying.
Right away. We're only in the first 2 minutes of the bout. Inside of the first 2 minutes of the bout, and Alvarez is already doing good work.
Yeah, he looks like to have a little bit high excitement right now as a pro debut. I would.
Yeah, and Luna doesn't really seem to provide too much trouble, it seems. You know, he looks like he's just here to survive, not necessarily putting out too much output or putting up much of a fight.
Definitely, as Alvarez goes for the kill again. Alvarez searching for that body. I like that.
And that's what you want in your pro debut. You know, it's gonna be telling of the future if you're able to go to the body and the head like you just did there.
Oh, and Luna takes a knee. He knows he's in over his head here.
Back at it, baby.
Let's see if Alvarez sticks with that body attack.
And Luna showing a little bit of a fight right there at the end of the round.
He made it through.
What did you see there from Ben Alvarez, Simon?
You know what I saw? I saw a lot of excitement inside of him. He looks like he has, you know, that pro debut. You want to make a good impression, right? But he did settle down towards the end of the round, did what he had to do. And I like how he's committing to the body and his pro debut. You don't see fighters usually do that. They want to go for the kill, nothing but headshot. But he's not headhunting.
Yeah, he's definitely not headhunting. But like I said earlier, Jorge Luna is just kind of like a deer out in the headlights, my man. He's
yeah, you know what? Yeah, that could make the fight look uglier when it comes to showcasing your skills, because when they're so unconventional, you don't know what's going to come. You know, the punches come from weird angles at times.
Yeah, right there when after Alvarez knocked down Luna, he tried to go in for the kill, but Luna put up a little bit of a fight.
Yes.
Connecting with the right hand. And here comes Alvarez again, pressuring forward with a jab. Showing good movement.
Good focus. Body and head. Oh, that's
that
a mean
hook.
That
was a thudding shot.
Yeah.
And
that
here comes
body
another
work
body,
too.
Body shot as well.
Alvarez digging deep. He wants to get him out of there.
Yeah, and Luna winced like that one hurt. That last one hurt. And there he goes
yeah,
again.
Those bodies
he's going to take a knee.
Yeah, the ref might think about stepping in here any minute.
But he's trying to the very end, is Luna.
Oh, Luna lands a big
shot. That was a good shot landed by Luna. Might be the best shot of the night for him. Didn't seem to faze Alvarez, though. Walking forward on him.
Oh.
And like you said earlier, Simon, Jorge Luna presenting a little bit of awkwardness, and it makes it hard to look good, you know, if you're Alvarez.
Especially I from what we're told, Alvarez has been in the ring with Canelo Alvarez, so he's not an unconventional fighter. So when you face a guy like this, it's kind of a whole other world that you're not used to.
Yeah, definitely.
But he does keep his hands up, so I like that about him. Come on, man. Another body shot.
Another body shot by you.
Oh, yeah.
That one was right on the button.
This is it. It was the body shot.
And referee counts out Luna. And Ben Alvarez wins his pro debut by knockout in the second round via body shot.
Hey, there's no feeling like that. 1-0, 1 KO.
1-0, 1 KO. Well said. And see if we can get a replay, Simon, because that was a beautiful, well-placed left hook to the body, man.
Yeah, and he followed up to the head, which I like that. He wasn't only committed to the body. It showed he was setting up for the head, but the body shot is what did the damage.
Oh, definitely. The body shot put him down. He was Jorge Luna was in agony in the middle of the canvas.
And you know what? A lot of respect for anyone who gets in here, though. A lot of people don't understand what it takes.
Absolutely,
you know?
My man. I'm totally with you on that one. Successful professional debut for Ben Alvarez, fighting out of the House of Boxing in San Diego, California. Looking forward to seeing more of him here in Best in Boxing.
You know what, I like his style, his footwork, his in and out. For being a big guy, he's pretty light on his feet.
Yeah, and you know what, I mean, at 6'2", like you said, you know, he was light on his feet. 39-9 amateur boxing record.
Yeah,
you know,
that's
that
good.
He was on the Canadian national team.
And some people might miss. Oh, here we go to Pablo Flores ringside.
Damas y caballeros, tenemos el tiempo oficial. 2:06 en el segundo asalto. We have the official time, 2:06 in round number 2. Declare your winner by the way of KO victory. Su vencedor por la vía del knockout, Edmonton, Canada, San Antonio, Chile, half boxing, San Diego, California. Benjamin, Big Ben Alvarez.
And making his way to the ring for our upcoming flyweight bout, our very first flyweight bout of the evening, Rigo Cruz from Agua Prieta, Sonora.
Yeah, it's definitely a change of pace at this weight. You know, you go from a little under 200 pounds to 112. We're going to see a lot of punches, I'm assuming.
Yeah, absolutely. We're going to see a little bit more of the high output.
Yeah.
And making his way to the ring, Salvador Cervantes.
Yeah, Salvador Cervantes, 1-0 right now as a pro, had his debut in June of last year. His best weapon is his left hook off of the jab. That's a punch we don't see too often, off of the jab.
Yep. Great to have, great to have. Hook off the jab. And we don't see it often, Simon, because it's hard to do.
That's right, that's right.
It's hard to do it if, Abby, you could do it, but it's hard to do it effectively.
Correct,
So let's see if Salvador Cervantes is able to do it tonight effectively.
Sporting the red, white, and blue with the East LA on the trunks.
East Los.
Boriseca Boxing Promotions presenta este encuentro pactado a 4 saltos en la división de peso mosca. 4 rounds of boxing in the flyweight division. Your 3 judges scoring. Sus 3 jueces: Jesse Hernandez, Sergio Lechuga y José Cobian. And when the bell rings, su referee a cargo, Ángel Méndez. Introducing the fighter standing in the blue corner, wearing black and silver. He officially weighs in 108 pounds. Su rival, presentando la esquina azul, vistiendo pantaloncillo color negro con plata, con un peso de 112 libras. He stands with a record of 2 victories against 2 defeats. Cuenta con un récord de 2 victorias por 2 derrotas. de Agua Prieta, Sonora, Rigoberto, el Rigo Cruz. And his opponent across the ring is standing in the red corner. He wears blue, red, and white. He officially weighs in the same 112 pounds. Y su rival en la esquina roja, vistiendo pantaloncillo color azul con rojo y blanco, con un peso idéntico de 112 libras. He stands with a record of one victory against no defeats. Cuenta con un récord de una victoria por cero derrotas. Representando, representing Black House Boxing, East LA, California, Salvador Cervantes. And now with the final instructions, para dar las indicaciones finales, su referee, Ángel Méndez. Four rounds, cuatro asaltos.
Gentlemen, protect yourself at all times. Obey the commands at all times. Touch him up.
And here we go in our third fight of the evening, Salvador Cervantes versus Rigo Cruz.
You know, he's fighting a guy with four professional fights, and right off the bat, we see that lead hook.
And like you said earlier, that's his best punch. He threw it right away. Let us know that that is his best punch.
Yeah. Yeah, he looks very determined very early.
And despite debuting in June of 2019, hasn't relatively stayed busy, Simon. He fought in June of 2019, and what could that possibly be? What was it? I mean, he did have 42 amateur fights. Didn't do much after that, but I mean, he has one professional fight, turned pro in June.
Yeah, you know, I don't know what the inactivity cause was, but what I can say here, what we see right now, is he looks hungry, like he's building. He has that in him where he's ready to let it out. It's been so long. And there we follow up with them double hooks. Oh, he's working them now.
And like you mentioned earlier, the output of the flyweights.
Correct.
And we see it. Definitely a change of pace from the cruiserweights that we were just watching in the ring right now.
Yeah, this is some good action. High skilled stuff.
And a good uppercut by Cervantes right there.
Cervantes staying focused.
And Rigo Cruz is there responding. You know, might not be at the same level as Cervantes.
Yeah,
despite having four fights.
Yeah, and you never know. He may be a slow starter. You know, we've seen a lot of world champions through history start off slow. Pedro Angulo usually loses the first four rounds, you know.
Yeah.
But we'll see if he got. Oh, wow.
Here's the thing, Simon. This is only four rounds.
Yeah.
So you can't lose all four.
Salvador Cervantes displaying some nice skills here. So he's representing East Los pretty good right here.
Yeah, absolutely. That was a hard body shot by Cervantes.
Look how ripped he is, man. This dude, you can tell he takes it serious.
Yeah, definitely. It can't be easy to make that weight, you know. And he's working hard to get down to the 115-pound division.
Yeah, he just put him down as well. And let's see if Cruz could withstand any more of this punishment.
Cervantes taking his time.
Oh,
and another body shot by Cervantes.
Yeah, those are pinpointed shots. Those aren't unplanned.
And there he goes again, coming to the body and then coming back up to the head. Good first round by Cervantes.
Yeah, that's a very
putting
good.
Rigo Cruz on the canvas.
Yeah, we'll see how Rigo Cruz responds to that after this round, because Cervantes looks like he's barely getting started.
Yeah,
This is a pretty cool venue that we got, that we have here.
Yeah, absolutely. This is a perfect venue for boxing. It's ringside seats and right above it, you know, and we're all focused on the ring. It's not really spread out. You know, it's a good venue for boxing. You could maybe even fit a cage in here. It would be great, you know. Good fighting venue. And here we go for round number two between Salvador Cervantes and Rigo Cruz. In the very first round, Salvador Cervantes put down Rigo Cruz with a well-placed body shot. And there he goes again, right back to the body.
Yeah, here the problem sometimes when you know you're outclassing a guy is you stop jabbing. I would like to see a little more jabs from Cervantes to get that that pace going.
Yeah, I think you're right. You know, sometimes it happens. You know, you put somebody down, and you think it's easy to do it again, and you kind of forget about the fundamentals. You know,
that does happen.
You take away from the game plan, but
oh my goodness, he's done.
Hard body shot by Salvador.
No, those are he's done. Yeah, he's done. That's it. And that's sort of liver shot. Perfect liver shot.
Perfect liver shot, putting an end to Rigo Cruz, bringing Salvador Cervantes to 2-0.
Wow. Yeah, there's no way he's coming up from that.
And Rigo Cruz grimacing in pain. That was a solid, solid body shot by Cervantes.
Salvador Cervantes, you know what? I've always said I'm most impressed with the body shot knockout.
Yeah, you know what, man? I agree. Those are hard. Those are hard to overcome. You know, yes, we all want to see a KO where you put the guy out, but here we can see the replay of that beautiful body shot.
Yes, he's searching for it. The little pivot.
Right there under the right arm of Rigo Cruz, perfectly placed by Salvador Cervantes. Brutal shot.
Yeah, I'm very impressed. I look forward to seeing Cervantes in the future. Yeah, you know what happens when you get hit in the liver like that? When the liver's shocked, that's the first organ before the rest. And when that is shocked, your body was shut down.
Yeah, absolutely. As a fighter, you know, you've experienced it one time in your career. and, yeah, it's an absolute shock, man. And you can see it right there on Rigo Cruz's face. It wasn't pleasant.
Yeah, that's a solid outing. Pretty good opposition, 2-2, a guy with a little three more pro fights than you coming in. Give him a chance.
And that's
to show
what you want for Cervantes' team, you know, is to put him against guys with experience as we bring it to Pablo Flores for the official announcement.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have the time of 2 minutes. 47 seconds in round number two. Tenemos el tiempo oficial, 47 segundos del segundo asalto. Declaring your winner by the way of KO victory. Su vencedor por la vía del knockout. Black House Boxing, East LA, Cali. Salvador Cervantes.
Salvador Cervantes improving his record to 2-0, sporting the East Los hat. Now, Simon, goofy question. Is he a Rams fan, a Charger fan, or is he a Raider fan?
Oh, man, I don't know. You know what? Cowboys have a lot of fans in L.A. too. But, yeah, we'd have to find out. Ask him.
We'd have to ask him. He's probably offended that I said Chargers, right? L.A. Chargers. One-year professional team in L.A.
You know what? This is a type of style that would represent Los Angeles very well, especially East Los Angeles.
Yeah, absolutely. He came forward. He boxed well. He ripped to the body. young guy, 2-0, you know, starting off 2020 with a bang, with a knockout. That's what you want. You're going to look forward to the rest of 2020. You know, hopefully we have him back in Best in Boxing. If not, more prominent promotions for Cervantes.
Yep.
But definitely the future looks bright for Salvador Cervantes.
Very, very bright. And here comes Jesus Gomez to the ring out of Sonora, Mexico.
Getting ready for our first lightweight fight of the evening against James Earle, who will be making his way to the ring very soon. And that's what we keep doing. That's what we keep doing here in Best in Boxing. We keep switching up the pace for you guys. You know, we had the cruiserweights, we had the flyweights. And now you have some hard, fast-punching guys in the lightweight division.
Yeah, in this division, you get the best of both worlds. You know, we all know that Manny Pacquiao and Marquez had their fights from 130.
Their best fights, yeah, in the lightweight division. You're correct.
James Earle. Coming into the ring from Snoop and Dr. Dre. Looks like he's in there with Kobe on the shorts.
Yeah, I mean, very big tragedy. You know,
I
commend James Earle, you know. Way to represent one of the greats.
42nd Boxing Promotions presenta este combate pactado a 4 rounds en la división de peso ligero. Let's get ready for 4 rounds of boxing in the lightweight division. Your 3 judges scoring. Sus 3 jueces. Sergio Lechuga, Jesse Hernandez y José Cobian. And your referee for this bout, su referee para este combate, Ángel Méndez. Introducing the fighter standing in the blue corner, wearing blue and white. He officially weighs in 135 pounds. Presentando ustedes en la esquina azul, pantaloncillo color azul con blanco, con un peso de 135 libras. He stands with 3 professional bouts. Cuenta con 3 combates profesionales directamente de Agua Prieta, Sonora. Jesús Isidro Gómez. And his opponent across the ring is standing in the red corner. He wears white with purple and gold. He officially weighs in the same 135 pounds. Y su rival en la esquina roja con pantaloncillo color blanco con morado y dorado con un peso idéntico de 135 libras. He stands undefeated with a record of 3 wins with no losses. Cuenta con un récord de 3 victorias y 0 derrotas. Representing San Diego, California, USA, Mamba Mentality, James Earle. The referee in charge for this bout, su referee, Ángel Méndez. 4 rounds, 4 saltos.
Gentlemen, protect yourself at all times, obey my commands at all times. Fight hard, fight clean, touch him up.
And here we go in the fourth fight of the evening in the lightweight division. You got James Earle versus Jesus Isidro Gomez from Sonora, Mexico.
Yeah, we'll see. This looks like James Earle might be trying to get this guy out of here pretty early.
Yeah, kind of like in our first bout, Simon. Darnell Price facing Brandon Acuna. Jesus Isidro Gomez looks a little soft in the midsection area.
Yeah.
And right away, James Earle going to the body like he should.
Yeah, and you know, he seems to be a power puncher, and he knows how to sit on those shots. Yeah, he's down.
And to be honest with our broadcasters, I mean with our audience, this broadcast, you know, sometimes we get fights like this. You know, this guy didn't seem like he came to fight. You know, kind of like he lied on the resume, right?
Yeah, you know what? And I, you know, James Earle got the good win, and he definitely did what he was supposed to do. Sometimes when that happens, and look at as he commends his opponent, you know, that's a sign of class right there, you know?
Yeah, and you know what? And that's why you get that stigma here in Tijuana. Oh, well, he fought nothing but cab drivers, you know. No offense to cab drivers. You drive a cab, good for you. But in this case, you know, it's not something that I like to see. Me as a fighter, you as a fighter, I'm sure that's not something that you want to see, you know.
Yeah,
kind of a mockery of the sport.
Yeah, and you know what? And that's the way James Earle took it. As you know what? How dare you guys put me in here with this guy? I'm gonna show you what I do to someone.
Yeah, I believe it was under 25 seconds that he went in there and just obliterated. Excuse me.
You know
me,
what?
Jesus Isidro Gomez.
What he can take away from this fight is it's an experience leading up to the fight. Making the weight, being under the lights, being ready, hitting the weigh-in, that also becomes repetitive. So here we go to Pablo Flores.
Before Pablo comes on board, I completely agree with you there.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have the official time of 41 minutes in the very first round. Tenemos el tiempo oficial, 41 segundos en el primer asalto. Declaring your winner by the way of KO victory. Su vencedor por la vía del knockout. With the Mamba mentality. From San Diego, California, James Earle!
And as we make time for the next bout, we're going to see this total annihilation by James Earle on Isidro Gomez. It just wasn't too much of a contest, Simon.
No, it wasn't. He's picking up shots and just teeing off on them.
And sometimes... And as we move to the super bantamweight division, we got Arcadio Salazar walking into the ring.
Yeah, he's an experienced fighter with 38 professional fights. So we'll see what he has to offer here.
As we see Jorge Villegas from Los Mochis, Sinaloa, making his way to the ring.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, Bodhisattva Boxing Promotions is proud to present 6 rounds of boxing in the Super Bantamweight Division. Damas y caballeros, 6 rounds de combate en la división de peso Super Gallo. Your 3 judges scoring this bout and ringside. Sus 3 jueces, Jesse Hernandez, Jose Cobian, y Sergio Lechuga. And your referee in charge, su referee para este combate, Juan Morales Lee. Enters in the fighter standing in the blue corner. He wears burgundy and black. He officially weighs in 122 pounds. Presentando ustedes en la esquina azul, pantaloncillo color guinda con negro, con un peso de 122 libras. He stands with 38 professional bouts. Cuenta con 38 combates profesionales de Agua Prieta, Sonora. Arcadio Salazar. And his opponent across the ring is standing in the red corner, wearing blue and black. He officially weighs in the same, 122 pounds. Presentando a su rival en la esquina roja con pantaloncillo color azul con negro, con un peso idéntico de 122 libras. He stands with a record, a perfect one. 7 victories and no defeats. Cuenta con un récord profesional. 7 combates ganadas por 0 perdidas. Representing Los Mochis Sinaloa and Espinosa Boxing Club, LA, California, USA. Jorge El Junior Pichegas. And now to give out the final instructions, your referee in charge, con las indicaciones finales, Juan Morales Lee. 6 rounds, 6 asaltos.
Sabe las reglas, llévalas a cabo, mucho cuidado con la cabeza. No rabbit point, no riñones, no bajo el cinturón. No golpes con el hombro ni con el codo. Dense la mano que gane mejor, fuerte.
And here we go for our super bantamweight bout. Jorge Villegas, Arcadio Salazar.
Yeah, we'll see what George Villegas could do here. He's 7-0, all knockouts.
Yeah, and 38 professional fights from Arcadio Salazar. You know, definitely some experience. You know, losing record, yes, but 38 professional fights, you have experience, you know. So if Jorge Villegas is able to get him out of there, continue his knockout streak, definitely going to be a bright future for Villegas.
Yeah, he's setting up a lot of lead hooks.
And good movement from Villegas. You know, not standing still. Typically, you have 7 knockouts to your record from 7 fights. You would think he's going to come forward.
Definitely.
And he's going to just try to blast through him. But no, he's poised, moving his head, coming behind the jab. Solid.
Solid jab. That jab.
And that was
like
a
lightning.
Solid jab right now.
Yeah, you know, another thing I've seen, he came in the ring with Frank Espinoza, a well-known boxing manager. So he definitely has something if Frank has him here.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, audience, take a look at Villegas. You're going to see him soon in maybe a world title fight in the upcoming years.
Definitely. Stays poised. He stays poised. Moving the head. A little faint.
That wasn't a knockdown. I'm glad the referee didn't call that a knockdown. He was at a bad angle, but he saw it. And a little wild from Salazar. Little unorthodox.
Yeah, this is where all the experience, this guy's had 38 fights, so the experience on knowing how to survive is there, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. if you were to take a look at him in the street, you'd say, oh, Villegas is going to run through him. But that's not the fight we're looking at right now.
Oh, the lead hook. Sharp.
Very good hook from Villegas, but Salazar took it well in fighting back. And a good first round of action between Jorge Villegas and Arcadio Salazar. You know, that experience, Simon, I mean, 38 professional fights, yes. Yes, you have a losing record, but 38 fights is 38 fights. You're going to know what you're doing, right?
Yeah, definitely, definitely. Let's take a look at this replay right here. So there's the lead hook.
And that's the hook you mentioned earlier that you said Villegas says.
Yeah.
It's his best punch. That was a pretty solid left hook right there. Could have came out a little cleaner, but it was a good shot thrown.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, and want to take note, you know, we want to apologize to our viewers. We had a little bit of technical difficulties hearing this from the truck right now. We understand. We're working on it. Hopefully you're staying with us, enjoying the fights just like we are right now. Versus Jorge Villegas and Arcadio Salazar in the super bantamweight division. Jorge Villegas, 7-0, 7 knockouts.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he put him down. Once the mouthpiece comes out, that's usually a sign of pain.
And 38 professional bouts. Little veteran move, spitting out the
see
mouthpiece.
That? Did you see that?
Buying a little extra time.
That's definitely a veteran move. You know, he's getting about 20 seconds total, 25.
That was a good amount of time added from the point of the 8 count. And Salazar trying to go to the body as well.
And you know, that's something for maybe a young fighter to pick up on. If he ever is hurt, maybe that's a tactic. You know, it's not praised highly.
It definitely is not. You know, it's something definitely frowned upon, you know. But Villegas, well poised, throwing good shots.
You know, I like how he keeps his hand. Wow. Lead right.
As you were about to say that, Simon, he gets clipped with a nice right hand by Salazar. But Salazar complicating things for Villegas here in this round.
Yeah, he's giving him a lot of movement here.
Yeah, awkward movement. And that's the type of fight you want for a young fighter that has 7 fights, 7 knockouts.
Yeah, you want
to take on a veteran like this and put him out.
Yeah, that's right. You get a lot of rounds in. Hopefully he takes him out early, but either way it's a win. You come out with a lot of rounds in under the lights. Good counter hook here.
And super awkward is Arcadio Salazar. I can't stress that enough. He's an awkward guy, man.
Yeah, he's definitely bouncing around and spinning this guy.
And
now he's on the attack.
Showing those veteran moves. Don't take this guy lightly, Arcadio Salazar. I mean, Jorge Villegas, definitely the much stronger guy, much more polished fighter.
Solid,
but I'm giving credit
solid
to Salazar.
Right hand. Yeah.
So, Simon, what do you think this does for a young fighter's development, fighting a guy like Arcadio Salazar?
Well, you know, it gives him something awkward to work with that he's probably not seen in the gym. Sometimes legitimate fighters and young upcoming prospects like this are used to sparring high-end pros and high-end amateurs. Now he's in there with a guy who's very non-conventional, and he's going to have to learn a few other skills while he's under the lights.
Yeah, to say the least, right? Like, this is very unconventional, and at times having a little bit of success, and maybe frustrating the young Villegas. I'm intrigued by this fight. I'm enjoying this fight.
Yeah, so right now in Villegas' corner, what do you think his corner gets him, is telling him right now with this veteran? What would you tell him in his corner?
So for me, as a fighter myself, and now transitioning to being a coach, go to the body.
Yeah.
Start
here
going
we go
to the body.
First knockdown here.
Yeah, as we see the knockdown here from Villegas, and it was a perfectly placed left hook, you know, and it was a counter hook. It wasn't a lead hook. I think that's what you said, that Jorge Villegas thinks is his best punch.
Yeah.
We don't really know yet, right? But he throws good shots all around. But
That was a counter.
He said it's his lead hook, but that was a counter. Yeah, you're right. That was a counter.
See, these are these veteran tactics right here. Stalling a little time.
Hey, man, take all the time you could get fighting a young lion like Villegas.
Villegas pumps a jab, and he leads with the hook. Oh, and a big hook by Villegas. Oh.
And he caught Villegas coming in, did it Salazar. So giving him a little bit of trouble is Salazar this round, but we'll see how long that lasts against the stronger, more poised Villegas. And like you mentioned earlier, you know, he's got a good jab. He's got a solid jab, which
definitely
is what you want. If he didn't have that jab, Salazar would be frustrating him a little bit more.
Oh, big haymaker thrown by Arcadio Salazar. See, with the high guard, that's why I like the high guard, because when someone's throwing, you'll always be able to block it.
The one thing we is preached, right, even on your first day of your boxing training, boxing lesson, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah.
Keep your hands up.
That's right.
That's it. Keep your hands up.
I mean, Julio Cesar Chavez's corner was telling them that in his 100th fight. You know?
Yeah.
It's something we all need
to
know.
Yeah, keep your heads up. It's funny, but, you know. Keep your heads up.
Good uppercuts as we see Villegas showcasing his other skill. Oh, a little showboating here.
A little showboating from Arcadio Salazar. You know, that once again, man, frustrating that the young fighter, you know, veteran moves, getting in his head, evading shots.
Yeah, as you see here, Salazar is grabbing him a lot and holding. So maybe that's a good experience to know what to work on in the future, you know, not just the boxing, but the to deal with a tactical veteran like this.
He honestly, he seems to be handling it fine, Jorge Villegas.
I mean,
he took that away from him real quick, went to the body a couple times, touched him to the head, nothing crazy. Just get his attention back on focusing on the fight and stop clowning around.
So we're in the last minute here, the third round. Villegas getting his work, though.
Yeah, Salazar might have just kind of mustered his last little showboat, because he hasn't thrown anything in that last minute.
Oh, as he complains.
In the last minute, yeah.
Oh. Yeah, you know what? I like this guy. He's saying, you know what? Come on, bring it, youngster, bring it.
Yeah, man. That, once again, man, something you're not going to learn in the gym, something you're most likely not going to – not going to fight in the amateurs, you know, like a nice or a good crafty veteran like Salazar.
That's the end of round three.
As we bring it close to the third round, Simon, in Villegas' corner, what are they telling him right now? Facing a crafty, unorthodox guy like Salazar.
Yeah, What I'm seeing his coach tell him right now, he's pointing to the body. It looks like he's telling him, don't focus so much on the body, that your man's going to be there. As you see the guy, Juan Cutman, for hire in the back with the ice on his back, keeping him woke, but at the same time, calming him down.
Yeah, you definitely don't want to be overzealous against a crafty veteran like Salazar, you know. Once again, losing record, 11-24-3, 38 professional fights. But that's experience, man. That's experience.
Is.
You can't teach that experience. And
that's
it
right.
Seems like he's teaching that right now to to Jorge Villegas, despite the fact that Jorge Villegas is putting on a dominant performance.
Yes.
But learning in the process, learning. And like you mentioned earlier, getting those rounds. That's what you want. You want to get these rounds.
That's right. Absolutely right. This guy's just so unconventional. It's crazy.
And once again, a sharp jab by Villegas.
Lead right hand.
Nice veteran move again, and we continue to praise that. For Salazar, he spun him around and gave him a little check hook. Trading body shots.
Those little short shots are, oh, and he catches Villegas, Salazar does.
No, he is catching him. I mean, who's doing the more damage? Who would I rather be in this fight? Obviously, Jorge Villegas, but Arcadio Salazar, he's holding his own, you know, more than we expected, right?
Yeah, definitely, definitely.
More than we expected.
He's tying him up, killing time, taking his shots when he gets a chance. As the ref has a tough time breaking him off right there.
Hey, you know what, man? I'm actually excited about this fight.
Oh, wow.
Down goes Salazar.
He's holding, his collarbone there.
He seems to be in a lot of pain. We're going to have to see that replay because I thought he hit him on the chin, and he seems to be holding his right shoulder.
Yeah, you never know. You know, that collarbone only takes a few pounds of pressure to break, so.
Despite of, well, first off, before I say anything, let's check out the replay here. Having a little bit of technical difficulties on the truck. And as soon as we get the word, here comes the replay of that knockout.
And you know, Villegas showing class over there. Showing class and making sure his opponent's okay, you know.
El propietario de un Audi absolutely. Negro, placas de California,
and here we go with the replay.
Audi, black Audi. Favor de moverlo, por favor. Have to move it from the dark driveway. Thank you. Gracias.
You know what? This is definitely the first time in. I've seen other shots, but this is the first time I've ever seen a knockout to the shoulder.
Wow, yeah.
It seems like it's popped out, and they're working on him right now, and he was in pain. You can't deny that pain that he was rolling around in, and they're working on that, and you see it. You see it right there. That's... So as we take a look at the replay one more time, that's a one in a million shot, man. That's a hard shot to land.
Oh, it was right on the collarbone.
Yeah.
Yeah, that thing looks broken.
Yeah, it definitely seems like it's broken. It's popped out on one side. As we could get the truck to take a closer look. And Salazar taking a little victory lap here. Getting acknowledged by the crowd.
We'll see. Maybe that was
it might have popped out. It might not. We don't know, right? We're not doctors,
hey, that
man.
Could but, be a
but we both saw, and I think we all saw it at home as well. It was a solid shot to the shoulder.
Yeah.
Might have popped it out for a second.
Now we go to Pablo at the ringside.
Ladies and gentlemen, this bout comes to an end officially with a time of 1 minute 31 seconds in round number 4. Tenemos el tiempo oficial, 1 minuto 31 segundos en el cuarto asalto. Declaring your winner by the way of KO victory. Su vencedor por la vía del knockout, Espinosa Boxing Club, LA, California, y Los Mochis, Sinaloa. Jorge! El Junior Villegas.
So Jorge Villegas from Los Mochis, Sinaloa, improves his record to 8-0 with 8
Sonora, Arcadio Salazar.
And probably could say one thing that I'm going to say 99.9% of fighters cannot say. I knocked my guy out with a shoulder punch.
Yeah, definitely. You know what, too? For all we know, that's a veteran move for him to when he knew he couldn't withstand this young guy's power, you know.
Are you saying more like a cop-out? Like, oh, I injured
kinda
my
like
shoulder?
Yeah, I mean, not as drastic as Tyson biting Holyfield's ear, but, but, you know, when you know you can't beat somebody, who knows what you'll do.
That's the cop-out of all cop-outs.
Yeah, we look forward definitely to see Villegas' future.
You know what? You brought me back, man. I was 9 years old when that fight took place. I still remember it. We watched it in my dad's house. Well, obviously, I lived with my dad, right?
Wow.
I was 9 years old. But it's something we always did. Something we always did, and we cherish every single time.
That's right.
To date, nowadays, we watch Canelo fight. Back in the day, it was Chavez fights, Tyson fights, De La Hoya fights. You know, it's something that has always been a big part of my family is just the boxing, man. Boxing brings my family together.
Yeah, definitely.
As we see Elias Diaz making his way to the ring, fighting out of San Diego, California, sporting a 6-0 record. Sporting the California love. So, Simon, Elias Diaz, former stablemate, or you know him well, right? Tell us about him.
Yeah, definitely. Elias, you know, I've had, man, I don't know, hundreds of rounds with this guy. I can tell you one thing. This guy has one of the fastest jabs in the game, you know. He has no tail sign on the jab. His dad keeps him nice and poised in the corner as his trainer, and he's very confident, over 100 amateur fights. And we'll take it up to the ring for now.
Boxing Promotions presenta 4 rounds de combate en la división de peso welter. Your 3 judges scoring this bout in ringside. Sus 3 jueces, Sergio Lechuga, Max Zúñiga La Bandera, y el juez internacional, Alejandro Rochin. And when the bell rings, your referee in charge, su referee para este combate, Juan Morales Lee. Introduce you first the fighter standing in the blue corner. He wears red and white. He officially weighs in 147 pounds. Presentando ustedes en la esquina azul con pantaloncillo color rojo con blanco con un peso de 147 libras. He stands with a record of 3 victories against 1 lone defeat. Cuenta con un récord de 3 victorias por una derrota. También de Agua Prieta, Sonora, Edwin Salcido. And his opponent across the ring, standing in the red corner, wearing black and white. He officially weighs in the same 147 pounds. Y su rival en la esquina roja, con pantaloncillo color negro con blanco, con un peso idéntico de 147 libras. He stands with a record, a perfect one. 6 victories against no defeats. Cuenta con un récord de 6 victorias por 0 derrotas. Representing House of Boxing, San Diego, California, USA. Damas y caballeros, introducing Elias Diaz. And now with the final instructions, para dar las indicaciones finales, su referee, Juan Morales Lee. 4 rounds, 4 saltos.
Conmigo, sabe la regla, llévelas a cabo. Dense la mano que gane mejor. Suerte para los dos.
Now, as we start, Simon, you know, I want to touch on the fact that Elias is 6-0, great, right? But he's a 4-year pro, fighting twice in 2016, once in 2017, once in 2018, and 2 in 2019. You saying that you sparred hundreds of rounds, you know, why taking it so slow?
Well, see, Elias is a man of many talents. He's very educated. He actually, as he hits a sharp right hand right there, he actually got a college degree, I believe, maybe a master's, but I know at least a bachelor's, and has started another career as well. So this is almost his side job.
And what a good side job to have, right? I know that he grew up in the boxing game. I used to see him as a young kid, you know, and I watch him now as a young adult, pretty much. But yeah, he had a successful amateur career. I know that. I was unaware of the education that you just mentioned, but kudos to him. And he's here doing what he loves.
Yeah,
know?
And although his dad had him at a young age fighting, Elias, the dad doesn't push him to fight. Elias chooses to want to fight, and the dad leaves it as that. And what happens there is you end up with a quality fighter because he wants to be in there.
Yeah, he wants to be, yeah. So sometimes it's that necessity that brings you up. And sometimes it's just a love for the game. You know, for example, you know, you have 6-0, Elias Diaz. And it's just a passion for the game.
Yeah, Elias is going to jump on a guy who's complaining. That's one thing for sure. He looks nice and sharp, as usual.
And like two of our previous fighters on the card, Edwin Salcido is a little soft.
Yeah, he is. You know, he's 3-1. We're seeing he kind of knows how to survive so far, but Elias, he actually tried out for the trials in the last Olympics. Didn't get to make it to the Olympics, but he definitely was
Okay, so right after he turned pro, he didn't make it. He gave it a go.
Correct.
And he turned pro.
Correct.
I understand. You know, and definitely, like once again, I didn't know about the the education, so
yeah.
Therefore that takes away a lot of your time, you know, being able to both it's hard.
Yeah, and you know what, he's a very mature young guy. You know, you don't see that. You know, a lot of guys want to party, and Elias is in the gym, you know, or he was doing homework, I remember. He was doing homework backstage before one of his fights.
That's cool, man. That's a good story right there.
Yeah, Elias looking nice and poised. Don't be surprised if it's lights out for his opponent pretty soon. He looks pretty relaxed.
Yeah, once again, Salcido doesn't seem to bring too much to the table. Being a little soft around the body.
He's a little squirmy too as well. And like we spoke earlier, that could cause a little bit of a discomfort for a skilled fighter to have to chase someone who's running around so much.
Yeah, basically just trying to survive. And it seems like that coming from Edwin Salcido,
yeah,
trying to survive. As we see a little bit of the schooling of Elias Diaz with the sharp jabs.
Yeah,
I stand corrected with the straight shots, you know, the 1-2s, the 1-2s. And fun fact, and it all came crashing down right now. So I do recall seeing him as a young kid.
Wow.
And in 2010, I fought Chris Avalos, who at the time, and I believe he still goes by the Hitman, right?
Okay.
So I remember just to be a goofball and just to kind of throw some wood on the fire, I said, you know what, I'm going to be Marvelous Chris Martin for this bout.
Okay.
I'm going to be Marvelous Chris Martin for this fight. So I remember that Elias helped me for that fight.
Oh,
just
wow.
Coming to train with me. And I said, you know what, man? I'm going to call you Elias Maravilla Diaz.
Oh, no way.
And he says I took his name because I said Marvelous.
Oh,
but his is in Spanish. Mine is in English, you know. But it was only for that lone fight,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
Still the San Diego kid.
Yeah, that's right. Oh, that lead right. Yeah, this guy, he broke his will. His will is broken. Yeah, that. Yeah, this guy doesn't want no more of that. The thing about Elias, he's so quick, you might not see it from the camera, but you can't see those
and
punches.
And he is going to continue. I'm sorry to cut you off, but he is going to continue. I was in complete agreement with you that he doesn't want to continue, but he does want to continue.
Hey,
he's coming forward
heart,
now.
He got his heart.
And he's trying to.
And you know what? Right there, I see Elias with a veteran tactic. A guy puts his head down. You're not going to take no chances.
Yeah, push him down. Head, yeah.
Elias tearing him up now.
Beautiful
yeah,
body shots.
Down on Elias Diaz knows this thing's about to be over. Oh, it's a fight. And Elias Diaz comes away with another victory.
Elias Maravilla Diaz.
Maravilla, 7-0.
It's gonna stick. It's gonna stick, Simon. It's gonna stick. But you know what? It doesn't do it justice. We're right here under the guys. And those body shots, man. Once again, we're going to see it in the replay. But you can't really hear the thuds. That one right there in particular, you could see me right there. And I'm wincing for the guy as well, man. Those were hard body shots.
Yeah, he just overwhelmed him. He was throwing so much clean shots at him. He was done there. And Elias will be fighting next week, from what I understand, in San Diego.
Wow. That's a quick turnaround.
Very quick.
Made quick work here tonight.
Yep.
Veteran matchmaker in his corner, Jorge Marron. Veteran cutman.
Yeah, and you know, a lot of credit to his father, Greg. You know, Greg's, you know, preparing him meals. He's in it with him, you know. And he's always told him, you know, if you jump to your career, that's fine, you know, in the business world. But Elias, you know, of course, Greg, the father, wants to keep him in boxing, but he doesn't want to push him into it, you know.
Of course. You know, something that we said earlier, you know, sometimes there's necessity and sometimes there's the love for the game. In this instance, it's that love for the game. And seems to be producing as we take it to Pablo Flores.
Este combate concluye con un tiempo de 1 minuto 54 segundos en el segundo round. We have the official time of 1 minute 54 seconds in round number 2. Declaring your winner by the way of TKO victory. Su vencedor por la vía del knockout técnico. House of Boxing, San Diego, California, USA. Elias Diaz.
Alright, so coming up next,
and before we get Elias Maravilla Diaz off the screen, I'm going to reiterate the fact that we're going to get this trending. Elias Maravilla Diaz. I know you're going to rewatch this, my man. You're going to rewatch this, and you're going to hear Chris Martin say it over and over, Elias Maravilla Diaz.
That's right. Yeah, so next we got the co-main event, and Jorge Brito, who we talked about when we opened this show.
Yeah, you know what? This is one matchup that I'm looking forward to. You know, you have an experienced guy with a winning record, 20-12, Juan de Jesus Angulo, actually coming into the ring right now. You know, once again, I'm looking forward to this fight. You know, see what Jorge Brito is going to be able to bring to the table here tonight.
Coming to the ring now is Jorge Brito. Co-main event, ladies and gentlemen. All right, we take it to Pablo
Ladies
Flores.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is your co-main event of the evening. Six rounds of boxing in the welterweight division. Damas y caballeros, por Azteca Boxing Promotions presenta el evento coestelar de esta noche. Six rounds in la división de peso welter. Your judges scoring this bout in ringside. Sus tres jueces. Sergio Lechuga, Max Zúñiga La Bandera y el internacional Alejandro Rochín. Your referee in charge, su referee a cargo de este combate, Juan Morales Lee. Introducing to you first the fighter standing in the blue corner. He wears red and silver. He officially weighs in 147 pounds. Presentando a ustedes en la esquina azul, pantaloncillo color rojo con gris, con un peso de 147 libras. He stands with 32 professional bouts. Cuenta con 32 combates profesionales de la ciudad de Agua Prieta, Sonora. Juan, sin miedo, Angulo, González. And his opponent across the ring standing in the red corner. He wears white with black and red. He officially weighs in the same 147 pounds. Presentando ustedes en la esquina roja con pantaloncillo de color blanco con rojo y negro con un peso idéntico de 147 libras. Representing Tijuana, Baja California y San Diego, California. With a near perfect record, 13 wins, one lone defeat, 13 victorias y una derrota. Aquí está Chivas Power, José Córdoba Brito. And now with final instructions, your ref in charge, su referee para este combate, Juan Morales Lee. Six rounds, seis asaltos.
Saben las reglas, llévenlas a cabo. Mucho cuidado con la cabeza, no rabi points, no riñones, no ojos de cinturón, no golpes de revés ni todo el codo. Dense la mano que gane mejor. Suerte para los dos.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, our co-main event is underway.
And I believe I did say this at the beginning of the broadcast, that I was looking forward to this fight more than anything. You know, you have Jorge Brito beat Kevin Torres, who's our main event fighter here tonight. But Juan de Jesus Angulo Gonzalez, that's a long name, I know, but winning record, 20-12.
Yeah, one thing that stands out to me is his height and reach. This guy's got to be 6'2".
so I believe we have him at 6'2 or 6'3". We have him at 6'3".
Wow.
6'3". 76-inch reach.
Yeah, he landed
147 pounds.
He just landed a good straight right hand, you know.
You know, and that was Jorge Brito's advantage when he fought Kevin Torres, being the taller guy. So now tonight, he's fighting a guy that's taller than him, which is rare.
Ooh.
You know,
Gonzalez lands a big shot.
Yeah, he's coming to win.
And that's a veteran move right there.
He clipped him right away. Hold.
And then, he holds him. That gets to your opponent in their head. Holding him again. He's messing up his rhythm. Brito looks determined, though, to come forward.
Yeah,
a big hook.
Long hook by Angulo.
He definitely came to fight. Keeping his distance. Just like you said, Chris, he's used to being the taller guy.
Yeah, he's used to being the taller guy. So what I was going to say is when he fought Kevin Torres, he was the guy boxing. Kind of a little role reversal as Angulo is the one boxing right now. And gets a stern warning for a low blow from the ref.
Yeah, Brito has to be careful right now to not be overly aggressive, because he is getting caught with some shots. Oh, big
He is
hook.
Getting countered, big but he lands hook. A good shot right there.
Yeah, he needs to remain calm. He looks like he wants revenge, but you got to remain calm, work with your jab, just like that, just like that. Big right hand.
And wow. Angulo is so long, man. Like, those shots typically wouldn't land if you're throwing them that awkward, but they're landing.
Yeah.
Like, they might not be the most effective shots, but they're landing, you know. And you could hear them. They're making, like, a thudding sound. So maybe the judges here are taking that into account.
Definitely. And that's a good round for the underdog. You come in like that, you're showing, you know what? You might be here to put on a show, but I'm also here. I'm going to take the show from you.
So would you say you gave him that round?
I would have to lean toward Gonzalez for the big hooks. I've seen him land about 3 clean, hard hooks. I've seen the frustration in Brito's face, and sometimes judges read off of that too when a guy looks uncomfortable.
Okay. I'm going to have to agree. I was on the fence, but I'm glad I'm not a judge here in this fight. But you persuaded me, Savvy. You persuaded me, and I agree. I'm going to go ahead and jot that down. First round to Angulo. And see what Jorge Brito could do, what he could do to change the game plan. If he needs to continue to go forward, box him. What is he going to do?
Yeah, we'll find out right now. Wow, it's so hard to prepare for a guy like this and to find a guy that size.
Not only that size, but that throws the right hand like he's throwing a baseball. So when I'm teaching my kids at my boxing gym, I'm definitely telling them to throw it straight. And I always, always tell them not to do exactly what Angulo just did. He threw it like a baseball. But we'll see how long that lasts for him. You know, as Brito starts to close the distance a little bit more.
Yeah, Brito's starting to work, though. Good body shot by Gonzalez. Ooh, good uppercut by Gonzalez.
As Angulo complains of a headbutt, Brito having.
These are definitely veteran tactics, you know. 32 professional fights. He knows how to kill time and kill the opponent's momentum.
Good hook landed by Angulo right there. And right away, closes the distance, hugs, grabs. And there we go, a warning from the ref.
You know what? Veterans are expecting warnings, too, sometimes. They know they could get away with one or two before they get a point taken away. Brito comes forward, and he's resisting the grab, and that's what he needs to do. Oh, a big hook again by Gonzalez.
Oh, wow. Right. Good shot landed by Angulo right there. Brito shook it off, kept walking forward. But it seems right now that Angulo is the one landing the crisper shots.
Yeah. We'll see how the fight unfolds after this. We got a...
I mean, Brito's definitely closing the distance, but that awkwardness, look, he goes in, he hugs, does Angulo, and then he sneaks
Good
in a couple
counter.
Shots here and there.
Yeah, Brito's starting to find his target here. You know, sometimes it could take a couple rounds to dial a guy in like this, you know. That's where it becomes the best in the world, make adjustments.
Absolutely, but right there, Brito's already getting frustrated. You see it in his face. He's getting frustrated.
Yeah.
When was the last time you ran at somebody like that in the gym, Simon?
Yeah, you don't do that. Not only that, you got to keep the poker face in boxing. You could be maddest person in the world. You got to keep that poker face.
Yeah. that's another thing that I like to teach. Whatever you're feeling, you put it on your poker face.
Yeah, that's right.
You're tired, you pretend you're not tired.
That's right.
You're hurt, you're not hurt.
That's right. Definitely. I remember taking some body shots from Canelo Alvarez. It hurt bad.
Oh, but, I'm sure, man. That's one of the most.
Yeah, but I didn't show it, and thank God he didn't throw too many more. Yeah, we're going to take a look at this body shot here.
So it seems like a little shot landed there. It made Brito kind of anxious and try to come forward.
Yeah.
You know, might have been off balance. We couldn't really see because of the angle.
Yeah. You know what? Brito has to relax because your rage could cause you to have bad judgment. And when you relax, you think better. Everything slows down for you.
Only six rounds. I have to say, I've given Angulo those first two rounds.
Yeah, I'd have to say that too. Brito did come with some good counter short shots, and he's getting worked, and we're getting sweat all over us here.
The sweat is free.
Brito looking a little frustrated here.
And there, and there goes Angulo throwing that right hand like a baseball. He's throwing that baseball.
Good straight left.
And he seems to have caught Angulo's attention. Did Brito following up, trying to follow up.
Oh,
and there goes another sharp left hand by Brito.
Oh.
And every once in a while, Angulo seems to muster a little bit of power, come forward, but
good short shot.
It seems like that power meter is starting
Definitely.
To dwindle.
Yeah, it's starting to fade out. And Brito looks like he's kind of just warming up, although he's frustrated.
Yeah, and Angulo has his mouth open.
He's definitely giving it
his all. Hugging every chance he gets.
He even threw a headbutt in right there. Oh.
I mean, those are 30 shots, but I mean, technique
yeah, correct,
wins
correct.
Over anything in a boxing match.
Yeah.
As Brito is just kind of picking everything off.
Oh, good counter, but there's no mustard.
Good counter, but I mean, the weary of the two seems like it's Angulo.
Correct.
I mean,
correct.
He had good first two rounds, but I mean, I'd like to quote Max Kellerman in saying that. After the first three rounds is when class starts to tell.
That's right.
And
that's
obviously,
right.
Jorge Brito is the better class
yeah,
in this boxing match.
Yeah, the adjustments. And you know, we're seeing the grit of Brito as a crowd chants, Brito, Brito, Brito.
I mean, I give it up for the toughness of Angulo, but this pace doesn't seem sustainable anymore for Angulo.
I agree with you, Chris. As the referee shoves him away. Yeah, Brito's starting to wear him down. He looks like he's barely warming up. Oh, if they give a cold stare at the end of the round.
So once again, you know, the pace that Brito is pushing doesn't seem sustainable for Angulo. Right there at the end, you know, at the beginning, those baseball throwing punches were landing, but right once you get a little tired, you know, the fatigue starts to kick in, those things just look sloppy.
Yeah, you know, that's why you're taught to always keep your technique. I had a coach, my first coach, Frank Mosley, told me, la forma primera. Form first, all the time. So we're going to show the replay right here on these guys trading body shots.
So there goes those lunging shots, and you see the crisper shots from Jorge Brito.
Yeah.
Just punching in between, you know, picking off Angulo shots pretty easy.
See if Brito settles down here. You know, Brito not being used to being the shorter fighter. I've heard it said by some old school trainers, I believe Joe Frazier's trainer taught, and Dwight Muhammad Kawi, their coaches told them, when you're smaller, when you're shorter than the other guy, you actually get more smaller. You make it harder for him. He's not, of course, accustomed to doing that, being the taller fighter.
Yeah, yeah.
But he's still outboxing him. I did give him a third round. Here we go.
I did as well. And like I mentioned, you know, class will tell after three rounds in a professional boxing
match. Definitely. Yeah, it looks like Brito's vision is cleared up. He's seen all those shots.
And
with bad technique and fatigue, you're not going to hurt Brito.
And you're not going to last long either.
Definitely.
Wide misses right there. And
Brito's working him.
Correct me if I'm wrong, though. When you miss a wide shot like that, you become more tired.
Oh,
right?
Yeah. It's pulling out of your gas tank. Especially when you're used to training and hitting at least back. He goes down. Brito puts him down. And the mouthpiece comes out. He's fatigued. This is where attrition kicks
out. And he's not getting up, ladies and gentlemen. You know, Juan de Jesus Angulo put on a good effort in those first two rounds.
Yeah.
Round three, that conditioning started to dwindle.
Yeah.
That technique got sloppier. And Jorge Brito closed the show in the fourth. With emphatic fashion, man. He just kind of bulldozed them. With just technique. Bulldozed them with technique.
That's right.
Good to watch.
And you know what? Sometimes experienced fighters, I remember Canelo Alvarez against Amir Khan. Canelo was losing most of the rounds.
Yeah.
But he timed him, and he caught him. Okay, and here we go with the knockdown. Replay.
And right here, Brito's already... knows he's already hurt, so he's just kind of coming forward, just throwing shots, trying to put a little cherry on top, you know. Like the damage was already done.
I think it was a fatigue factor that Brito obviously is in well condition, and he said, I'm gonna push this guy, drag him to deep waters, and then I'm gonna drown him.
Definitely a good showing from Jorge Brito. He had a little trouble. You mentioned in the early telecast that Jorge Brito wants to perform. He wants he wants to supersede Torres. But did he do it here tonight?
You know what? In the end, yes. Here we go to Pablo Flores.
Concluye con un tiempo de 1 minuto 35 segundos en el round número 4. And ladies and gentlemen, we have the official time of 1 minute 35 seconds in round number 4. Declaring your winner by the way of KO victory. Su vencedor por la vía del knockout. De Tijuana, Baja California y San Diego, California. Jorge, el Chihuas, Córdoba.
We see in the locker room, we got Kevin Torres waiting on deck, looking nice and chiseled, clean cut, got the beard going, the Mexican flag. Yeah, so Kevin's coming into this fight, and Chris, you were talking earlier about him, his original opponent falling out and putting a late replacement. How does that make a fighter feel when he's prepared for a certain opponent and there's a sudden change at the end?
Well, typically, you're throwing a little wrench in the gears, but I said typically. This ain't typically. We're here, and to be honest, this is a stay busy fight for Kevin Torres. He was already programmed to fight a much better opponent. Late replacement in Alejandro Almada. But I mean, anything could happen. But it seems like the chips are stacked in the favor of Kevin Torres.
Yeah. I'm seeing something backstage here with Brito wishing Kevin Torres good luck. That's a great sign of sportsmanship.
Hey, absolutely, man. I mean, that's something you want to see between two former rivals, you know?
Correct.
And that might be a sign that we'll be able to see it again. You know, we're going to be able to see this fight again. Because the first fight was a good fight. I enjoyed it. I actually fought that night. Might have been my last fight of my entire career.
Right on.
But I remember watching it from the rafters and kind of just jumping up and down, man, because it was a fantastic fight. It was a really good fight. So hopefully we see the rematch. That's all I'm saying.
It was the first time Torres touched the canvas, and maybe that threw him off because it seemed like he was really trying to go for the kill after that. Brito took that in and moved around him.
Yeah, kind of what Angulo did to Brito right now in the first two rounds.
Correct.
You know, Kevin Torres wanted a fight. Brito said, "Nah, I'm good." Continue to box him, hurt him twice, put Kevin Torres on the canvas twice. Kevin Torres was able to finish the fight, but still, you know, the better fighter that night was Brito, and tonight he showed a much different style. He was a come forward fighter against a taller, lankier fighter, which I doubt you're going to see a taller, lankier fighter than Brito at 6'2".
That's very rare.
At 6'2", he happened to find a guy that's 6'3". You don't see that often.
Yeah,
you know, I think if I'm not mistaken, Paul Williams, 6'1", welterweight?
He was 6'2", welterweight.
6'2", welterweight. Yeah. I see there you go. Correction. You know, obviously a shame, Paul Williams.
Yeah,
the way the career ends.
Yeah.
But definitely a great man.
I remember,
Antonio Margarito is going to annihilate Paul Williams. What happens?
Yeah.
Paul Williams comes in and puts it on Margarito in that fight. I mean, I remember watching it on TV, silence the Carson, what is it? I don't know why I can't think of it. The Home Depot Center.
Oh, okay.
The Home Depot Center in Carson. I'm sorry,
right,
man. But I'm just a little excited as we see Kevin Torres getting ready for his main event bout.
Yeah, with his head trainer, Carlos Barragan Jr., they definitely know how to build fighters over there at the House of Boxing, as you see Carlos Sr. as well. And we're headed to a commercial right now.
Thank you.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, as we come to our main event, walking into the ring right now, late replacement Alejandro Almada. Alejandro Almada has not fought since December 21st, 2018. So he took a nice little vacation in 2019 and taking a last minute fight against Kevin Torres here in 2020 to start the year. As we see Kevin Torres making his ring entrance.
And we go to Pablo in the ring, Pablo Flores.
Damas y caballeros, espera terminado. El momento llegó. Ese es el combate estelar de esta noche. Seis rounds en la división de peso super ligero. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time to rock and roll with our main event of the evening. Six rounds of boxing in the super lightweight division. Your three judges scoring this bout in ringside. Sus tres jueces, Sergio Lechuga, Max Zúñiga La Bandera, y el internacional Alejandro Rochin. And your referee in charge of the action, su referee para este combate, Juan Morales Lee. Ahora bien, amigos que nos siguen a través de la señal de VIP, The Best in Boxing, y Fight Hub TV en YouTube. Y los presentes, estamos en vivo desde la Big Punch Arena, desde la frontera más visitada del mundo, Tijuana, Baja California, México. ¡Ajusten sus cinturones! Enters into your first, the fighter standing in the blue corner. He wears white and silver. He officially weighs in 140 pounds. Presentando a su rival en la esquina azul, pantaloncillo en color blanco con plata, con un peso de 140 libras. He stands with 13 professional bouts. Cuenta con 13 combates profesionales de Tijuana, Baja California. Damas y caballeros, presentando a ustedes a Alejandro Almada Franco. And his opponent across the ring, standing in the red corner. He wears black with red and silver. He officially weighs in the same 140 pounds. Su rival en la esquina roja, pantaloncillo color negro con rojo y plata, con un peso idéntico de 140 libras. He stands with a record of 15 victories, one defeat, one draw, and 10 of those victories coming by the fast way of knockout. Presenta un récord de 15 victorias, una derrota, un empate, y 10 de esos combates por la vía rápida del cloroformo. Ladies and gentlemen, from Bellingham, Washington, con sangre de Mazatlán, Sinaloa, and representing House of Boxing, San Diego, California, USA, the Diamond Boy, Kevin Torres!
Let's go, aquí conmigo los dos. Escucha. Sabe la regla y es la cabo. Mucho cuidado con la cabeza. No rabbit point, no riñón, no ojo, cinturón. No golpes de revés ni con el hombro. Una pelea limpia que gane mejor suerte.
And here we go in tonight's main event. We have Diamond Boy, Kevin Torres versus Alejandro Almada. Reminder, Almada is a last minute replacement on a 1 day notice. Hasn't fought since December 2018. Yeah. Don't blink, folks. Don't blink. Kevin Torres, one punch KO power.
Oh, yeah, definitely. And anyone with the last name like Torres, you know they're a beast.
I got you, sir.
Mi amigo, no se nos vayan a ir. Tenemos dos combates
Kevin, nice
más.
And, relax.
And ladies and gentlemen, we have two more bouts
double jabs
coming our way.
Yeah, we're going to see what Almada has to bring today on the short replacement.
On a one-day notice. Obviously, he was training. You know, he's got good form.
He lands a 1-2.
He doesn't look sloppy.
Yeah. Definitely, you never know in these TJ gyms, you know, what you're going to find.
Oh! Nice left hook by Kevin Torres.
A straight right
already
hand.
Got Almada's attention right in the beginning of the round.
Yes, Kevin looks pretty real light on his feet, you know. Normally, he's sitting down trying to kill his opponent. This time, he looks really, really light on his feet.
You're absolutely right. It's something that was kind of a detriment when he fought Jorge Brito.
Correct.
In December of 2018, you know, his lone loss. Kind of just stuck in the mud, you know?
Yeah, correct. As Torres steps forward. Torres keeping his distance. Has a style like Canelo, actually.
You know what? I've said, nice left hook right there by Torres, and I've said that a while ago, you know?
Oh, straight right hand.
When he was 4-0.
Kevin, starting with the jab. I'm liking the jabs. He's sporting the Cleto Reyes gloves, which everyone knows is a puncher's glove.
Yes, definitely a puncher's glove. And what I was going to say, back when Kevin was 4-0, he fought Javier Oladea. And that was one of the most brutal one-punch KOs I've seen.
You know what?
You remember that? Okay.
It was a hook.
It was a solid hook. The guy just... was out before he hit the ground.
Yeah, he outdid me because I had a knockout of the year before, and then, you know, they were both cold knockouts.
And what I do remember from the telecast is that I remember comparing it to Canelo, because right now you said
okay.
Canelo.
Correct.
So I remember I said that it reminded me of Canelo knocking out Carlos Baldomir
the way he fell.
Yeah,
right?
The way he fell. Javier Oladea went backwards.
Okay, correct.
And Baldomir went forward against Canelo. But both were out before they touched the canvas, you know.
Yeah.
It was just a solid shot by both fighters. Canelo at the time and Torres.
Yeah, you know, one thing about Torres, too, his whole life's committed to this sport. He was able to... Signed with a good manager, Christina Carrillo of Jab Management. She handles him. He's getting the best treatment, cryotherapy, and of course the good training element of it at the House of Boxing.
And that's what you want as a young fighter, is to have somebody to manage your career. You know.
Yeah, definitely.
If you ask me. Let me add to everybody listening at home. I'm retiring 31 and 12. I'm giving myself an extra win.
Hey.
Not gonna do that. But towards the end of my career, they'd call you up. Hey, you want to fight next week? Yeah, I want to fight. As opposed to having a manager who's gonna take care of you.
That's right.
Who's gonna take care of you? When as a fighter, if you have the say so, yeah, you're gonna fight everybody.
Yeah, yeah.
I'll fight you in the corner. Whatever, right? But that's what you want.
The manager brings the business aspect.
Yeah, the business aspect, and you want to set that ego aside. Because for me, that was a big part of it, you know, just the ego. So there's no ego. There's no ego coming from Kevin Torres landing those thudding shots to the body and to the head right
correct,
now.
Correct, correct. Yeah, Kevin's looking nice and sharp here. He's walking him down, hands high, jabbing, head movement. I'm liking what I see. Counter right hand. Yeah, he's on him. You know, he comes from good people, too, man. His dad, I'm his friend on Facebook with his dad as well as Kevin. And his dad's so proud of his son, you know.
Definitely, man. A father's always proud of his son, man. And in a brutal sport like this, man, to have his father's support, I'm sure means
definitely,
a lot.
Definitely, Kevin with a nice head movement.
Once again, that's what you want.
And Kevin's very well balanced on his shot. He can throw a hook, right? He could double him up and still keep his balance.
And that was a hard uppercut by Kevin Torres.
Oh, he eats an uppercut, too. Oh, and a right and a left.
And Almada fighting back, landing good shots against Torres, but it doesn't seem to faze him too much right now. If anything, Almada lands shots and seems to be stumbling, and he falls into the ropes.
Wow.
Kind of like a last effort right there, you know?
Yeah, less desperation.
Desperation, and he dropped the mouthpiece in the process.
Yeah, he's buying time.
Yeah, he definitely is buying.
Oh, it looks like the fight's over. Why did they stop
this fight? So the fighter spit out the mouthpiece, waved his head no. The referee has no choice but to wave off the bout.
Yeah, I guess I could try to understand that, but, you know, that's as a fighter, if I'm in Kevin's shoes, I'm like, man, I want to finish the guy, I guess we got to protect the fighters, the referee.
This one right here is a touchy subject because at the end of the day, we're here for entertainment.
Definitely.
And, I mean, the fight was entertaining. It was picking up. And the ending was...
We knew what was coming.
Obviously, we did know what was coming. But for it to end like that, shame on Almada. How about that? Just shame on Almada.
Dos combates más.
Because there was nobody else. We saw him right here. He spit the mouthpiece out. Shook his head.
Yeah.
Gave the ref no other alternative. You got to stop the fight.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, we seen it last weekend with Deontay Wilder and Tyson Fury. I thought that fight should have been stopped a round and a half or so before, personally. I didn't see no response from Wilder, who normally responds very well.
Yeah, definitely. Did not see a response. But, once again, we're here to be entertained.
Correct.
He knows what he's signing up for.
Correct.
And is what it is.
Yeah, you're right. Pablo Flores in the ring.
And ladies and gentlemen, this bout comes to an end officially with a time of 1 minute and 55 seconds of round number 2. Tenemos el tiempo oficial, 1 minuto 55 segundos del segundo asalto. Declaring your winner by the way of TKO victory. Su vencedor por la vía del knockout técnico. Bellingham, Washington. Puritito Mazatlán, Sinaloa, House of Boxing,
dude?
San Diego.
Races.
The Diamond Boy, Kevin Torres.
¿Qué onda, jefe? Siempre están ahí.
A ver, que le eche una vueltecita para allá. ¿Eh? A ver, que le eche una vueltecita, a ver qué día.
Ah, Simón, ok. Yeah. Cuando gusten. So in the replay here coming up, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to see a few shots that were landed on Kevin Torres before he was able to stop Almada.
Yeah.
You know, these were wild shots from Almada. No real technique behind them, but we got to say, I mean, Kevin Torres took him well. You know, the last efforts by Almada, Kevin took him well. And Simon, as a fighter, you want a strong chin. You don't want to get hit. But you want a strong chin, right? Like,
Definitely. Yeah, you don't want to take pride in having the strong chin, but it definitely helps. So when you could have a good chin and also have good defense, you're double covered, you know. You're double covered.
That's a good way to put it. You're double covered. I like that. Double bag it.
Yeah, there you go. And you know what? The only thing is you don't want to get hit too clean too often, because you will face punchers, especially Kevin will face punchers in that loaded 140 division. So
yeah, absolutely, man. You're right. You know, I think I'm gonna call out my man Joe Rogan. That it's like a punch card. You know, you have a card, and there's only so many you can punch.
Correct.
Before you run out. You know.
That's right.
And to me, that I completely relate to that. As a younger fighter, I took decent shots.
Okay.
But then towards the end of my career, I could not for the love of it take any shot. You know, it was hard. You know, so I'm completely with that analogy. So going back to what you just said, you don't want to take too many of those shots.
Correct. And no one knows the punch count till it comes.
Till it's there.
And
it's
too late, you know. Coming out is Japethli Yamido, Filipino. A standout amateur. 127 amateur fights. Was hoping to go to the Olympic trials, but they said there was too much politics involved, and they said, you know what? We're not going to wait for 2024 Olympics. By then, we'll be chasing a world title. That's their thinking.
Yeah, like, ultimately, as an amateur, you are training to become a professional fighter. You're getting seasoned. You know, for those, you know, those fighters, Vasily Lomachenko,
yes,
that had a ton of amateur bouts and very successful as well. You come in, and you already come in with pretty much like a doctorate. You know what
correct,
I mean?
Correct. That's right.
And some fighters come in with a bachelor's.
Correct.
As for some TJ fighters, they probably come in with a high school diploma at best.
Your three judges
GED.
Scoring this bout in ringside. Sus tres jueces.
We go to Pablo
Max Uñiga La Bandera, Sergio Lechuga y Alejandro Rochin. And your referee in charge, su referee para este combate, Ángel Méndez. Introducing the fighter standing in the blue corner. He wears blue and silver. He officially weighs in at 127 pounds. Presentando ustedes en la esquina azul, con pantaloncillo color azul, con plata, con un peso de 126 libras. He stands with three professional bouts. Cuenta con tres combates profesionales de Tlaquepaque, Jalisco. Jonathan González. And his opponent across the ring in the red corner. He wears blue and black. He officially weighs in the same 126 pounds. Y su rival en esquina roja, pantaloncillo color azul con negro, con un peso idéntico de 126 libras. He stands with a record of one victory against no defeats. Cuenta con un récord de una victoria y cero derrotas. Hailing out of Norwalk, California, USA. Perfectly, Liamiro. And here's to give out the final instructions, your referee in charge. Para dar las indicaciones finales, Ángel Méndez. Four rounds, cuatro saltos.
Gentlemen, you were given the instructions at the dressing room. Protect yourself at all times. Obey my commands at all times. Ya se le dieron las instrucciones en el camerino. Protéjanse a todo momento. Sigan las instrucciones que ganen mejor. Good luck to you both. Touch him up.
So as we kick off our first swing bout of the evening, Japhethli Yamido versus Jonathan Gonzalez. And if the folks at home don't know what a swing bout is, I'm going to inform you guys. I want to keep you guys informed. As a professional fighter, so these guys, Japhethli Yamido, 1-0. Jonathan Gonzalez, 0-2. Typically at the beginning of your career, you're most likely gonna be placed in swing bouts. What swing bouts means, ladies and gentlemen, so you have to wait around. if there's a lot of knockouts, if there's plenty of knockouts, you're going to be on right away. You're going to get slotted in there. If fights go the distance, you're going to be the last one like you are here tonight. You know, and I'm glad that I was probably took part in about one or two swing bouts as opposed to other guys that had plenty.
Quite often, huh?
Yeah. So it's a thing, man. Just so everybody knows, as a professional fighter, you don't want to be a swing bout. You're probably going to be a swing bout at one point in your career, but you don't want to be.
That's right. That's right. Japheth Lee just digging in on him. I'm feeling the bright shoes as well.
Yeah, I like him too. But it seems like Japheth Lee Yamido doesn't like the fact that he has to wait around to fight at the end of the night. He's bringing it.
Yeah, and Japheth Lee looks super, super sharp. The only thing I could say I would like to see is for that chin to be tucked a little lower.
I see that as well.
He's going to dominate a lot of his opponents in the early part of his career. You just don't want to get caught by one.
You know what's funny? We spoke to him earlier in the fighter meeting, and we asked him because he's 1-0, and we don't really have too much information on him, right? And
he just switched as a
I saw that. We asked him, definitely. What is your style? If you have a style, what's your style? He's a counterpuncher. This whole time, he's been walking forward on him.
And countering him. Look, he got the little Roy Jones showboating going on there.
There you go. I like that.
From Norwalk, California, Japheth Lee Yamido. Remember that name. Came out southpaw, now he's orthodox. Not many fighters can do that.
Working both sides of the brain there. Son.
Yeah, and he has those quick twitches like a Mayweather. You see the quick pull counter?
Might be a little too early to compare, but.
No, I'm just saying he probably picked that up trying to emulate it.
I see it. I see what you're saying.
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
But, yeah, man, he's got fast hands. And in a boxing match, like I mentioned earlier, when Jorge Brito fought Juan de Jesus Angulo, you know, time will tell, and class will tell.
Correct.
That's what I meant to say. Class will tell.
Okay, I see.
You know what I mean?
As the fight progresses.
As the fight progresses.
I see.
And right here at the beginning, you see right here these guys are closely matched, but it seems like Japheth Lee is gonna take off.
Yeah, correct.
It seems like it. I'm not gonna say that's what's gonna happen, but it seems like it. You know, my experience, my knowledge, I'm trying to put it together. And he definitely threw some good body shots, as we can see right here, in the replay. That one right there, he felt it.
Yeah, he definitely felt that. You know, one thing I saw right there was. He's been fighting with his hands down off and on, but when he's in close quarters, he has them high. So I've always liked that in a fighter, and he right away gets started with the jab here.
And that right there, you're understanding distance.
That's right.
You know where you're at. You know where you should be doing. And that's good, man. That's exactly what you want to see from a young fighter.
Definitely.
I like it, man. He's...
Yeah, I like his style. You know, boxing, you know, sometimes.
And he's coming forward.
Yeah.
He's coming forward. He's aggressive.
Good uppercuts. Keeping the head moving.
And one more thing that I like to teach to my young fighters is that jab to the body. We
correct.
Don't see that often.
Correct, correct.
And you mentioned Floyd earlier.
Oh,
Floyd
yeah.
used to do that a lot.
Definitely.
He used to. Just pick at you.
Yeah, definitely.
Open you up and jab you to the body.
And even if it doesn't hurt, it's a subconscious thing to a fighter to know I'm getting
it's
hit.
It's bothering you.
Correct.
More than anything,
correct.
It's bothering you.
And Andre Ward also did that. And
yeah.
it can suck the wind out of you if you don't breathe right at the right time, right in that solar plex.
And a little acknowledgement from Gonzalez. Like, yeah, you got me.
Yeah. Okay. Well, we got a correction. It looks like Lee is from East L.A., not Norwalk.
Either way, he's representing very well here.
So he looks like a Los Angeles Charger for sure. You can correct me
if it if it's wrong.
Jeff Ali, you can correct me if you'd like. But I'm pretty sure you're an LA Charger fan. So why we see such good technique, you know, the trainer of Jafet Lee Yamilo, former trainer of Bobby Pacquiao.
Correct. Yeah, so that tells you the schooling he's getting, you know.
Yeah, he's just staying sharp. Freddie Norwood, just staying sharp, you know, has experience and knowledge in his corner.
That's right. Hey, Chris, to develop a fighter, how important is it to have a coach and trainer like that?
Well, you want the guidance, you know, more than anything, right? But when you have somebody that's been to the top of the hill, you know they can get you there
that's
as well.
Right.
And it gives you confidence. You know, more than anything, it just gives you the confidence. Hey, listen, my guy knows what he's talking about.
That's true. And you know one thing too is you might not know what it looks like as a young fighter at the top of the hill from that, the view from up there, but as long as your coach has, he can tell you what to expect.
Yeah, once again, it plays into the fact that it's confidence. More
than
anything,
it's
just confidence, you know.
And how many fighters have we seen? I'll refer back to Deontay Wilder last week. He didn't look too confident.
It was a little bit difficult to look confident.
Let's check out this replay here with Jafet Lee.
Kind of like Jafet Lee Yamido's looking confident here.
Quick
counter
left.
He doesn't have too much in front of him. But to touch back on the champ, Deontay Wilder, that confidence was taken from him, man.
Correct.
You have to give props to Tyson Fury.
I agree. I believe a lot of it was taken before the fight because Fury wasn't letting up on any remarks or anything in any aspect before the fight.
Yeah, he definitely wasn't. That resounding confidence that he
normally carries. Huh? And also that 40-pound suit didn't help either, you know. But they also showed him training. They also showed him training in a 40-pound weight vest. So
that I don't know, man. but you listen, I'm gonna give my assessment right now. There's a little bit low in the action here of that fight. So Tyson Fury just had a brilliant game plan. Wilder cannot fight going backwards. He's used to.
True.
Being the stalker,
being
coming
feared.
Forward. So I said this to one of my friends.
Good.
Shout out to Victor Heredia. What's up, homie? I told him because he was saying like, oh, what is he doing? So what would you rather do, go downhill or uphill? Tyson Fury was making Wilder go uphill the whole fight.
Correct.
On his heels, backpedaling. And maybe that weight advantage too that Tyson
Definitely.
Fury had, you know? He was a big boy, man. He's a big
huge,
boy.
Huge.
And to have that guy leaning on you and pressuring you, who's going to be able to keep that up for 12 rounds?
Correct. Oh, some mean uppercuts here by Jafet Lee Yamilo. Man, that jab is lightning.
It is lightning fast, man. I like it. Touch back
Look at
on
that.
The fight.
And a quick straight left. This guy, man, I'm really digging this guy's. And he's having fun in there. You know, he's enjoying what he's doing.
Yeah,
little
showboating. He definitely looks slick, man. And going back to that jab, see that bothered him right
away.
It bothered him.
Yeah. Oh,
and that right there set up that hook to the body.
Wow. Yeah, he is not getting up.
You soften him up with the jab, and then you explode with that body.
That was the same exact double shot Canelo threw against Liam Smith that I remember. He touched him a little upstairs, and then around the elbow.
Yes.
Man, I don't know if he's gonna continue here.
It's touch hard. Touch
Correct.
Hard.
And you
man.
Plant
yeah.
while you're about to throw it.
It doesn't seem like he's going to make it out of this round.
Yeah, Hernandez.
Got 45 seconds left, but But there you go. There goes that jab again by Yamido.
Definitely showing a maturity for a fighter who's only second pro fight.
And that was almost very bad if that last shot would have connected.
Yeah, definitely.
While he was down. There's not that much time left. See if he can close the show. 15 seconds.
10-second mark. Still walking him down. Double left.
Gonzalez did the right thing there at the end. Just, hey, live to fight another day.
Yeah.
Took back steps, trolled around the ring, come out for the third round. Excuse me, the fourth round. You know what? This fight has been so good. It went by fast. And that's what you get with the lighter weights.
That's right. And you know what? It looks like the corner of Hernandez is telling him, like, hey, what's going on, man? What's going on here? Are you okay?
They seem to be assessing the situation. He seems to be fine. He seems to be responding. Is Gonzalez going to come out for the fourth and final round?
Ladies and gentlemen, Boristeca Boxing presents round number four, your final round. Damas y caballeros, este es el round número cuatro, el último round.
Here we are, final round. Japeth Lee Yamiro, remember the name. Ooh, a lead hook. Oh, and Hernandez showing some fight in him.
Showing some fight, but Jafet Lee throwing in between those shots.
That's right.
That's what you want. You want to fight. I mean, excuse me, you want to throw punches in between your opponent's shots if they're wide.
Definitely, absolutely. Oh.
And turns back to orthodox.
He's really digging in for that body.
Yeah, and it's kind of hard to
there it is again.
Yeah, he seemed to hurt him there with that last body shot. But what I was going to say is, like for the corner, to tell him to stop it, because why would you? He's having success, you know?
Correct.
But typically you tell your fighter, hey, what are you doing? Turn back around. You're not Terrence Crawford.
Yeah. For real.
But you know what? Yamido's doing it fine. He's
definitely. Yeah, he don't stop. That jab's just like a piston that just keeps going. Oh, that's straight to the
another
solar
body pit. Shot. And I'm starting to hurt for Gonzalez over
here. Yeah.
And those shots from Gonzalez don't seem to have too much energy, man.
Yeah.
What does that do to a fighter, Simon, if you're not really, like, landing hard, but you're just touching him? What does that do to you?
Well, you know what? It can create frustration, but it's to me, it's a sign of dominance that, look, I can hit you. They might not even hurt. I've been hit by guys who jabbed or were really busy. It isn't good getting a hit, you know?
I think I agree with that. The little sign of dominance, just touch. Because it doesn't seem like Gonzalez is going anywhere, you know. Yamido's having a hard time as far as getting him out there.
Yeah, he's outclassing him, but this guy's just a tough guy. Some people are just born tough. They got that grit in them.
Yeah, sometimes a little too tough for their own good.
Yeah, that's right.
With all those body shots landed by Yamido, Gonzalez might wake up tomorrow with a little blood in the urine.
Yeah, see, and I would say standing this close to a puncher like Yamiro, things like that are going to happen. You're going to get touched.
And right before the round ends, the last round, Yamiro closes the show.
Pulled out the knockout. Pulled it off.
But it was the body work, man.
Man, exactly. I like this kid.
And if we can get a camera on Gonzalez, Okay, too late.
We're
going to
show our last knockdown.
Replay of those solid body shots. That one in particular, right on the liver.
Oh, yeah.
And he's folding. He's already quitting there. See, that one and that one, those last few ones were just icing on the cake. Because those were hard shots, man. Those were definitely hard shots.
Definitely.
So here we see the second knockdown in round number three. Just complete dominance from Yamido. And we see it right here.
There's that jab to the body you talked about. Oh. That's that, man. Touch and load up.
Yeah.
Pablo Flores ring in the ring.
This comes to an end officially with the time at 2 minutes and 49 seconds. In the fourth and final round. Damas y caballeros, tenemos el tiempo oficial, 2:49 en el cuarto y último asalto. Declaring your winner by the way of KO victory. Su vencedor por la vía del knockout from Norwalk, California, USA. Jeff Finley, Liamiro.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, as we approach our final bout of the evening, not the main event, because the main event was Kevin Torres versus Alejandro Almada. But for all you viewers that did not hear my little speech earlier, this is the last swing bout of the evening, the last swing bout. We have Adrian Alvarado against Guadalupe Garcia from Sonora, Mexico. And I want to let everybody know that Adrian Alvarado is from East LA, because we had Norwalk in our paperwork earlier. Not from Norwalk, East
correct,
LA.
Correct. And he's training at a Maywood boxing gym, and I believe the Molina twins train there. A lot of good pros are out in that. They get a lot of action, a lot of sparring over there.
Yeah, absolutely. The Maywood Boxing Club, very prominent boxing club fight out of L.A. Let's just say L.A. County, right?
Definitely, making its way to the rings, Guadalupe Garcia from Sonora, Mexico. You know, it's something to see when you see a fighter walk in the ring at the very beginning. His confidence doesn't look too high.
You mean at the beginning of their career?
No, I'm talking about the guy who just walked in at the beginning of the fight. You know, this guy, Garcia, showing low confidence. We'll see what happens, though.
So as we hear it from the truck, I'm going to reiterate the fact that Adrian Alvarado is from East LA. And the third one in a row, Simon, he's most likely a LA Charger fan.
Oh, man, probably.
As we bring it to Pablo Flores.
Damas y caballeros, Buristeca Boxing Promotions presenta este último encuentro pactado a cuatro rounds in la división de peso Super Gallo. Ladies and gentlemen, our last bout of the evening is set for four rounds of boxing in the Super Bantamweight division. Your three judges scoring this bout in ringside. Sus tres jueces, Sergio Lechuga, Max Zúñiga La Bandera, y el internacional Alejandro Rochín. And your third man in charge of the action, su referee, a cargo de ese combate, Ángel Méndez. Presentando ustedes, en la esquina azul, con pantaloncillo en color negro con plata, con un peso de 122 libras. Introducing the fighter standing in the blue corner, wearing black and silver. He officially weighs in 122 pounds. He stands with 4 professional bouts, 4 combates profesionales de Agua Prieta, Sonora, Mexico. Guadalupe Garcia. And his opponent across the ring in the red corner. He wears red and white. He officially weighs in the same, 122 pounds. Y su rival en la esquina roja, pantalones en color rojo con blanco, con un peso idéntico de 122 libras. He stands with a record of 1 victory against no defeats. Cuenta con un récord de 1 victoria y 0 derrotas. Hailing out of Norwalk, California, USA, Adrián Alvarado. And now to give out the final instructions, Angel Mendez. 4 saltos.
As we begin our final bout of the evening in the super bantamweight division, we have Adrián Alvarado versus Guadalupe García of Sonora, Mexico.
Yeah, I'm definitely feeling the suede or velvet trunks there and the Under Armour boxing shoes. Oh, and he puts them on. Puts them on the mat quick.
You know what, Simon? I didn't even see that shot. I was looking away. I was in the transition of looking at the monitor and looking up at the ring. So I can't tell you what that shot was.
You know what I noticed? He has that snap on his punch.
And a good comeback from Garcia after getting put down.
Yeah, Alvarado was actually helping out Carlos Cuadras in some sparring, so that shows you the opposition he's used to being in there with.
I mean, oh.
Looks like they
traded. So the referee's going to call it a knockdown, and I believe it was. It was a quick short right hand, and see if we can see it on the replay in between rounds.
Oh.
If Garcia makes it out of this round, it doesn't seem like he will. And the referee puts an end to it.
Yeah, that was
I mean, good showing from Adrián Alvarado. You did what you're supposed to do.
Yeah. And there you have it. 2-0. Adrián Alvarado.
Of East Los Angeles.
Definitely. I like this kid.
Very young fighter. Told us in a fighter meeting he has 70 amateur fights.
Yeah.
That's good. That's
definitely.
It's a decent amount of amateur fights.
Yeah, definitely.
For example, you're a professional fighter. How many amateur fights did you have, Simon?
Me? I had 20.
20.
I started late, so they were all with men.
Yeah. No. I understand. I'm just so the crowd gets a feel of what it is to be a seasoned amateur.
Correct.
Coming in to be a good pro. Because he looked great.
Yeah, and he has the advantage from all that. And what a lot of people don't take into account as well is 70 amateur fights. How much sparring do you need for that amount of fights?
Absolutely, yeah. Tons of sparring, I assume.
With a time of 1 minute and 39 seconds of the very first round. Tenemos el tiempo oficial, 1:39 del primer asalto. Declaring your winner by the way of KO victory. Su vencedor por la vía del knockout. Norwalk, California represents Adrián Alvarado. Y los queremos invitar la próxima función de Boristeca Boxing Promotions en el Four Points by Sheraton en San Diego, California. Allá nos vemos. Allá nos vemos el siguiente mes de abril, 3 de abril, viernes 3 de abril. Muchísimas gracias a la comisión, patrocinadores, al Big Punch Arena. Se despide de ustedes su seguro servidor, Pablo Flores. Dios los bendiga y nos vemos hasta la próxima.
So, a good emphasis at the end of the night, you know, closing the show, Adrian Alvarado from East Los Angeles. I got you, my man. I know we had a little mishap on our notes. We all had the same papers. Pablo Flores had the same papers. Called you out of Norwalk. You're not from Norwalk, my man. You're from East Los Angeles.
East LA.
You're a Charger fan, as am I. tonight. Wonderful fights, man.
Yeah. We saw
a lot. We had
some
knockouts. We had some good competitive fights. I think just about everything.
Yeah, you know what? We've seen some lesser opposition do more than we expected them to do. The unorthodox part of them, the very unconventional way of fighting, gave the higher-level fighters something to deal with.
Yes.
Something, somewhat of a challenge in that aspect.
And somewhat of a challenge. Like Jorge Brito got a good challenge fighting a guy that was a little taller than him.
That's right.
Something that is not what you see when you're a 6'2 welterweight. You see a guy taller than you. That doesn't happen.
It's
you know?
Not usual.
But tonight was a good night of boxing, best in boxing. We hope that you guys are here with us for our next showing. I hope Marcos, my man Marcos Villegas, is here with us in the next broadcast. Couldn't make it here tonight. He's moving on to bigger and better things. Congratulations, Marcos.
Congratulations.
My man here, Simon Torres. You know, we had good chemistry. It was good. Good knowledge of the sport for both you and
me.
And we had an excellent card today. You know, best in boxing. This is what it's about. Seeing the prospects. That you don't see the progress at the beginning, but you're seeing it here on Best in Boxing.
Definitely, definitely. Yeah, definitely. And you know what? One thing we could take away from this is even though some of the opposition wasn't all that, it still gives the higher-level fighter a chance to go through camp, make weight, get all their nutrition right, prepare for the fight, be under the lights, and knowing you're being watched on TV.
Yeah, absolutely. You get that experience. You do that whole fight camp. Like you said, you make the weight. You're here under the bright lights. Some fights in particular, I believe it was James Earle. I'm sorry, my man. You didn't have the best showing. I mean, you
great
obliterated
showing,
your opponent.
Great showing.
Obliterated. But it wasn't the best showing from your opponent. But once again, guys, thank you. We had a wonderful showing, best in boxing. My name is Chris Martin, here with Simon Torres.
We're signing off.
Had a wonderful show here today. Very proud of the show that Bodhisattva put on tonight.
That's right.